Is that okay? Okay, so first of all, let me thank Richard for the invitation. I'm delighted to be here. I'm going to be talking about shadow banks or non-banks in a very narrow context. So I think my talk is going to be complementary with Sujit's. His is taking a much more macro perspective. My talk is going to be much more micro in nature. So I'm going to be focusing on the US context and on the US syndicated corporate loan market in particular. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm first going to provide some basic facts about shadow bank entry into this market. Well, first I'm going to tell you what a shadow bank is in this context. And then I'm going to talk about some basic facts about shadow bank entry in this market. Then I will run through some causes and potential consequences. At least on the academic side, is the much better understanding of the potential causes of entry in this market. Much less is understood about the potential costs and benefits. Okay, and then finally, I'm going to wrap up by talking about some gaps in our data and the related gaps in understanding. So from an academic standpoint, if I wanted to do more research in this area to better understand the costs and the benefits, how you guys could potentially fill in the gaps. Okay, so just first to settle on some definitions so we're all on the same page, I'm going to be talking about non-banks that are unaffiliated with bank holding companies. Okay, so many of the shadow banks that people think about will either have direct connections to bank holding companies through direct organizational affiliations or through guarantees. I'm going to be focusing on unaffiliated institutions. These institutions are going to fund corporate loans with their balance sheet. Okay, so they are, for instance, it will be an asset manager that holds a corporate loan in the balance sheet, as opposed to distributing it immediately after purchase. So these institutions might involve leverage, they might involve liquidity and maturity transformation. This is a much more broad definition. Hopefully we'll get a bit more narrow towards the end. A syndicated loan is a loan that's co-funded by a group of banks and or non-banks. And all of the evidence I'm going to present today is going to be based on a supervisory credit register of syndicated loans called the Shared National Credit Program. Okay, this is administered by the US federal regulators, so the FDIC, the Fed, the OCC, until recently the Office of Thrift Supervision. They've been surveying these syndicated loans going back to the mid-70s, 1977. So, and what's really interesting about this survey is that it includes a list per loan of all lenders that are funding a given corporate loan, so in one of these syndicates, and it includes all of the banks, that was the primary focus of the regulators, but it also includes all of the non-banks. Okay, so this setting gives us a nice laboratory to study how non-banks have been entering this market over several credit cycles. We can see in the distant past and in the current state of affairs. Okay, so let me just quickly describe what this market looks like. This is 92 to present. This is showing the, not the levels of the market, but this is showing the composition of the funding in this market. Okay, so if you ignore the colors for now and just focus on the trend, if we go from the left-hand bar is 1992, the right-hand, the far right is something like 2014, so more or less present. There has been a shift in the composition of funding from traditional deposit-taking financial institutions, so bank holding companies. In 1992, they were funding about 75% of the market, so the complement that gets us from 25% to 100% will be these traditional banks. And if you fast forward to present, that relationship has flipped. Okay, so now you have the lion's share of the market being taken up by non-bank financial institutions that are unaffiliated with both domestic and foreign bank holding companies. The second pattern you're going to see here is there is a shift in the diversity of institutions funding these loans. Okay, so you have corporate loan securitization on the one hand, but you also have asset managers, you have hedge funds, you have private equity, and so on, those non-bank financial institutions holding these loans in their balance sheets. Okay, if you look at the distressed loan segment of the market, the same patterns exist. So in the distant past, it was mostly banks funding this market, funding the loans in this market. And if you fast forward to present, it's now almost entirely funded by non-bank financial institutions, so nearly 100%. And we're seeing more asset managers and hedge funds and so on showing up in this market, but also more corporate loan securitization as well. Okay, so why is this going on? So there are two prevailing views here. One is that these shadow banks, these non-bank financial institutions, have comparative advantages. Okay, so they can provide cheaper funding. They may be bringing new technology to the market as well, which is how they provide this cheaper funding. So if you think about the residential mortgage market, it's a leading example. You have fintech. The way at which they're able to price risks and so on is perhaps better than traditional financial institutions. But also, we can think about securitization as bringing lower cost of funding to this market. The other prevailing view is that this is regulatory arbitrage. Okay, so as traditional financial institutions face binding regulatory constraints, so we can think about capital requirements. More recently, we can think about liquidity requirements and so on. There may be this term that's been used so far this morning, leakages from the traditional sector to these non-bank financial institutions. So in the US, macro Pru has recently shown up in this market. It's specifically in the syndicated loan market, also called the leveraged loan market. The Fed issued guidance on underwriting standards. And as a consequence, more of the origination and funding of these loans actually shifted into the non-bank sector. Okay. So as a result of this regulation, we observe more leakages to either affiliated entities within the bank holding company. So the leading example here is you have a bank that has a CLO in-house, and credit is being shifted into the CLO, which may have lower capital requirements. So swapping $100 of loan into $90 of AAA rated security and carving out the rest and selling it off. The loans may be funded by unaffiliated entities, or there may be some kind of mix. So you may have an unaffiliated entity plus some guarantee providing the funding. So much more is understood on the causes at this point as far as the academic side is concerned. I have some work myself looking at capital regulation and capital requirements. For example, the implementation of the US implementation of Basel III and how that led to leakages from the traditional deposit-taking financial institutions towards some of these non-bank financial institutions. Much less is understood about the consequences of this shift in credit, mostly because there are gaps in the data. So it's very difficult to actually measure how much of the credit in this particular market is taken up by these non-bank financial institutions. That's why we're leveraging this supervisory data. It's been quite an exercise putting that together, but we believe this is going to provide opportunities to study in more detail some of the potential consequences. For instance, on the positive side, the supply of credit and also the efficient allocation of risks. On the potential costs of this entry, it's not obvious. Some of the problems, we have opacity, there's information asymmetry, which can due to adverse selection and moral hazard issues. There's mixed evidence documenting how pervasive those issues are. But these non-bank financial institutions certainly have less access to government guarantees and central bank liquidity. Okay, so they're potentially an unstable source of funding. I think that's a relatively uncontroversial statement. And so in terms of consequences, this can matter for credit cycles. Okay, there could be too much credit in good times, but there could be sudden stops in bad times. As far as the banks that are operating in this market, as you might have gleaned from the first couple of pictures, they're really in the underwriting business. Okay, so they're originating and mostly distributing to these non-banks. So that process can break down when the non-bank funding dries up. So this has more recently been referred to as pipeline risk. Okay, this can potentially have real effects for borrowers. So there can be knock-on effects to the real economy. We're in the process of trying to document those types of effects in a credible way. I'm going to show you a couple of pictures on secondary markets. The idea here is that if the non-bank funding is unstable, if it's more slippery, then in the bad state of the world, these non-bank institutions could be scrambling for funding. This could lead them to dump the assets on the market, potentially could lead to a fire sale. On the other hand, if these non-banks are fast-moving sources of capital, we might expect to see capital inflows to at least some of these non-bank institutions, and potentially they could be liquidity providers in this market. So these are unresolved questions. I've got a couple of pictures which, you know, at least in this context, can show how the evidence is very mixed even at this stage. Okay, so this is showing secondary market trading activity. So the US syndicated loan market, there is an active secondary market for these corporate loans. They're traded over the, participations in these corporate loans are traded over the counter. Okay, this is showing, again, 92 to present. This is showing, we're able to back out trading activity from our credit register by looking at flows. We can actually look at flows across sectors and also flows within loans. And what I'm showing here is on the buy side, so institutions that are flowing into the loan markets are picking up participations. And so there is, you know, there is trading activity during normal times. That trading activity tends to pick up during bad times. This is actually the distressed segment of the market. Okay, so that's very important. What we see in 2008 and beyond, that these non-bank institutions, the trading volatility actually spikes and it stays a lot higher than it was in the past. There's a broad range of non-bank financial institutions showing up in the market. So there are asset managers, there are hedge funds entering the market. Somewhat surprisingly, well, it's surprising to me, at least when you first started to do the analysis, you have corporate loan securitization, so CLOs, as an active buyer in the distressed segment of the market. Okay? So at least at a first glance, this looks like these non-bank institutions, or at least some of these non-bank institutions, are providing liquidity to the market during these times of stress, and in particular, during the segment of the market where we'd expect the traditional financial institutions that may be capital constrained to be offloading credit. Okay, so if you think these banks are attempting to recapitalize through secondary markets, then it appears that these non-banks are actually providing, at least some of these non-banks are providing liquidity. That was quantities, this is prices. Okay, so as I said, there's an active secondary market for participations in this market. This is 2006 through 2011, looking at prices in the market. So at the beginning of the period, 2006, these loans were all trading at 100 cents on the dollar. There was a big drop-off in the market starting in the middle of 2007, which persisted into 2008, and there was a recovery beyond. So what we do in this is just some very coarse evidence that's consistent with one of the hypotheses we test in our research. So we're looking at what we can do with our register is we're able to characterize loan syndicates going into the financial crisis. So if you think of the beginning of 2007, the end of 2006, you can, for a given loan which is being traded in this market, you can characterize exactly which institutions are funding that loan. And if we believe that the identity or the liability structure of those institutions, those non-banks funding the loan, is going to matter for fire sales and how that loan is going to perform in secondary markets during the bad state of the world, you might expect to see some differences in prices showing up. Okay, and so that's exactly what we're documenting in our research, and exactly what we're showing in this chart here. So there are two lines here. There's a dark line and there's a dashed line. Roughly speaking, the dark line we can think of as loans where the marginal investor is something like an open-ended loan mutual fund, corporate loan mutual fund, where the liabilities tend to be more short-term, more liquid. And the dashed line is something like an insurance, the marginal investor is something like an insurance company, so long-term, stable funding. Okay, and we're starting to see some variation across the secondary market prices, depending on the liability structure of that non-bank. So you might ask whether or not fire sales matter. For every fire seller, there's a fire buyer. That might be consistent with what we showed in the previous picture. But this is the data point that I want you to consider. Okay, so just to wrap up. So we have some gaps in our data, gaps in our understanding. As far as the understanding is concerned, there are open questions here. Okay, we'd like to be able to understand the relative importance of these various factors for explaining this non-bank entry. And then we'd like to also understand, in terms of the consequences, we'd like to precisely measure the costs and precisely measure the benefits. I've done nothing along those lines so far in this discussion, and also very little in my own research, but that's kind of a direction we'd like to head in. How can we get there? Well, there are various measurement issues and data issues at play here. So in what I think is a fairly remarkable data set that we're working with, there's a very coarse classification of these shadow banks. There are only coarse entity types. We have no information on which of these institutions, how these institutions are funded, the liability structure of these institutions. We have no idea of how levered these institutions are, maturity mismatch, illiquidity, whether they're guaranteed, and so on. So one, you know, leading complication with our analysis is the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, where many of these funds are registered. They do not speak with the Federal Reserve in ways that we hope they would. Okay. Thank you.
Well done keeping the time, too. Thank you very much.